when you were two. How did that affect you?
It's not easy growing up with parents who have split up. You know, I think it was tough at some times. It's only from becoming a parent myself that I can look at them very different lights and think they were kids. They had no idea what they were doing. You know, both my mum and dad were independent and they wanted to go in a slightly different direction.
You didn't see your mum here for many years. You're close these days and reconnected later, but I wonder, time has given a different perspective on that, especially now that you're a parent yourself too.
It makes you realise how important actually those relationships are and how tricky it is to be in a relationship and to survive a relationship splitting up. I think there were times when I'd slightly cross with various parents for various things. It was tough not seeing my mum all those years. I think it does make a kid.
But what kind of thing?
Whether it was your fault. That's another thing that I'm so keen with my kids to understand is that, you know, what happens to adults as you're growing up is not your fault. But I was very loved and very supported, and everybody gets on great now, so that's good.
Let's take a little break for some more music. This is disc number 3. What is it?
This is Righteous by Ocean Wisdom featuring Rince Manuva and Rodney P. The wonderful thing about your kids growing older is that no matter how much you try to influence them, their music take next left. Died on, not you. Woody is now 19 and we had a car journey recently and he said, well, I'm going to play some tunes. And he's brought some great music into my life.
They say, Woody, are you crazy? Ambitious, I'm so lazy. With a rocket through the roof of my
room. 300 feet, turn left.
Commander, we're voting, but what's the best in the new place? The decent religion, crazy.
Double fire button, 100 feet, turn left.
The best of all my weeks, they can't be the best of all my weeks. Now, who are you? I've got time for free. No one of them have money for the bus, now we can put it up in a new scooter. And I got pee, and I got hair. I'm on Thomas on beach, and I got powers on balance on the streets. It's the one beef me, and all of them will weep. But I'm pop, hold up.
In 100 feet, turn right.
See, and I get mad at the complete.
You ain't got skill like that. You ain't never gonna end up on a girl like that. You gonna pull from the ground for a girl like that. You can't pop like me, you won't pull like that. I said, you ain't got skill like that. You ain't never gonna end up on a girl like that. You gonna pull from the ground for a girl like that. I can't pop like you, I won't pull like that. Hey, come by there, go. Get on the power, so I
spend 100 feet, turn right.
And it's time for the day, when I'm out for the place of the castle. Hey, come by there, go. I'll forget it. If I'm out on the ground, go back to the past, I'll stop that. Hey, come by there, go. I'll forget it.
Righteous Ocean Wisdom featuring Rince Manuva and Rodney P. So Zoe Bell, you're born in Blackpool, but grew up in Buckinghamshire, went to school there. Did your reports give you any clue of your future career?
I think my reports mainly said if Zoe Bell spent as much time on her work as she did in entertaining the rest of the class, she would go far. I used to do terrible Zoe Bell productions, which were usually...
What was a typical Zoe Bell production?
I think I did Annie once. We used the flying cranes at the back of the school hall for cleaning up the bridge. And Daddy Warbucks, you know, trying to say... God, they must have been dreadful. And I went to convent school, and some people say that explains a lot. I could, at one point, recite most of Matthew Mark and Luke, not John. I think all I can remember now is 'twas on the road to Capernaum.
So after all levels, you went to City Poly in London to do a degree. Now it was Media Studies, Geology and Computer Science.
Of course,
which sounds like in 100 feet, turn left.
Result of someone not reading any work for A-levels. So I took the first thing I could find, and I was in this class of geology students who'd done geology for about a year. I had no clue what was going on. They all had these tiny little hammers and used to go to the beach and talk about limestone. I make second left. I had no idea.
So you decided to leave after 4 months, did you? Did that feel like a big decision?
It kind of did at the time. I don't think anyone within City Poly noticed I was gone.
So your dad, he helped get you your first grade then, this job?
Well, he kind of did. He made an introduction. I went and worked with this guy for a bit, and then I ended up working at Granada Television. And that was great, because that was the first job where there really wasn't any introduction, and no one knew. who my dad was, which was great for me, because it was very much, you've got to make your own way, and you've got to learn. I was so incredibly naive. I worked with some incredible women on this kids' show. It was on B Sky B. It was presented by Michaela Strack, and Mark Curry presented it for a while. It was called Cool Cube. I was in charge of the cookery items. I was terrible. I used to go to the supermarket and buy muffins, take them out of the wrappers, and then get these kids to just pull them out of the oven. I mean, it was such a scam. But I loved it. Take that, we were on our show. I mean, 16 of the guys, and they're all wearing cycling shorts. But it was great fun, and I learned an awful lot about television very quickly. And then I worked on game shows and all sorts. I was like, this is my life. This is what I want to do.
And did you love being in Manchester? It must have been quite an exciting time to be there.
I'd been there for 2 years before my hairdresser said to me, what do you mean you've never heard of the Hacienda Zoe? And little did I know that as I was living in Chilton, Wooling Range, going on around me was this incredible musical revolution. So we made me go to the Hacienda, and my life changed forever.
With that in mind, I think it's time for your fourth disc.
Well, I had to choose the Stone Roses. I've gone from Shoot Me Down. I had this really lovely moment of going to see them recently at the Etihad with lots of my friends from Manchester. And where we were, I mean, the average age in the audience was, I guess, you know, 50, pushing 60, and stone cold sober. We danced all night. Not everyone else was stone cold sober, I was stone cold sober. We danced all night. They were phenomenal. And we walked back from the Etihad into the centre of Manchester in the pouring rain, everybody singing. And it was such a moment, and I just love them.
Is a researcher on children's BBC, and for Planet 24 that made the world and the Big Breakfast. Insofar as you had a career plan back then, what was it?
I guess in the back of my mind it was that I wanted to be on screen. Also, you know, I grew up watching Tisler, Sally James, I thought it was amazing. Andrea Arnold used to present Number 73 on roller skates. That's what was in my mind. And then I got a call that children's BBC were looking for presenters. I sort of finally plucked up the courage and went across. I did an audition with Andy Peters where I had to talk about an inflatable dinosaur for about 20 minutes. And the great thing about going into the BBC and the children's department was they taught you about broadcasting. I've taken a look back actually and watched a few episodes of Live and Kicking in the run up to this. Obviously watched plenty in my younger days, but there's been
Keep left.
These big live children's TV programmes. There were a moment in those days, and they're made with the expectation that you've got everybody watching together, and that's all the different generations, all the members of the family are probably going to get something different out of it.
Keep left.
Will Smith there, getting involved in sketches with the leprechauns, Mr. Blobby, and then great bands coming in. These days, what do we get? We get and watch cooking programmes. Not quite as anarchic
While you were presenting Ivan Kicking, you also co-hosted the Radio 1 breakfast show. In 300 feet, he left the successful female presenters at the time, Radettes. Late night drinking isn't really compatible with an early start.
I was...
Yes.
Those things didn't go hand in hand. I wince when I hear that word, Radette.
I mean, this was the thing.
Radio 1 saw a girl who was out living a bit of a life, and they're like, what we want is you go out and go to the parties and meet the bands and come in and tell us all those stories. I took that slightly too literally. And thank goodness for Kevin Greening, the wonderful Kevin Greening, who held that ship for many, many months, whilst I would go off out and about and come in and tell the stories. It was a real moment in time. You know, there was Britpop, the music scene was fantastic. There were these superstar DJs coming up through the ranks as well. And I was sort of in my mid-20s and was happy to go off to the Enemy Awards or the Grammy Awards or come back and report or go off and interview John Bon Jovi or whatever I was sort of asked to do. I think meeting Norman is probably when stuff ramped up even more so. So that's Norman Cook, also known as DJ Fatboy Slim. I remember them coming in and saying, Radio 1's going to go to Ibiza. I thought, oh, okay, yeah, that sounds fine, let's go, that'll be lovely. And Sarah Cox saying to me, I'd never met Norman before. I knew Fatboy Slim, I'd loved the House Martins. I mean, if you'd shown me a video of the House Martins when I was 15 years old, I said, you're going to marry him, that guy in the video there. But I would be like, are you crazy? Of course I'm not. And Sarah said to me, you're going to love Norman Cook when you meet him. And so off we went to Ibiza, pack all our little bags and we go off. And I met Norm, and I did indeed love him. There was this bonkers brilliant chap who played records and made people dance, and he would like conduct the crowd and the audience, and I just thought he was wild and free and great fun, and it was sort of the beginning of a beautiful friendship. It's time for some more music. Tell us about this next one. When I first met Norm, it took us a while to get to know each other. There was a little bit of wooing involved, and the old way of wooing, of course, was the classic mixtape. So I made Norman a mixtape.
Who went first?
Yes, I went first. Who makes a DJ a mixtape? What was I thinking?
Wow.
So I made him a mixtape, and then he made me a mixtape. And the track I chose next featured on that mixtape. And he brought me into a world of fantastic music, great fun, parties all around the world. He also became a father to my two wonderful kids, and I have so much love for him. And this is a track that will always remind me of those very early days, all of us hanging out, a lot of laughter, a lot of daftness. And it's Love Having You Around by First Choice.
Prepare to keep left in 2 miles. First Choice, that track for your ex-husband Norman Cook. So did you run it past him. I did write past him and he was quite pleased. And the cassette still exists. You guys married in 1999. Now, the following year, you walked away from one of the biggest jobs in radio. Why did you leave radio?
I think it was a bit of a whirlwind. I think from meeting Norman and everything had wrapped up, suddenly the tabloids were really fascinated with our life. And it's kind of a thing when you end up, I think, perpetuating myths slightly of sort of almost living up to expectation. And there were so many people everywhere that we were, and I don't know, it just felt like I needed to step back a little bit. I mean, it was wonderful because great people would come into the house. He'd worked with amazing people, and I'd sort of have to pinch myself. Iggy Pop came to stay for a while. David Byrne came to stay at the house. That was quite a moment. You'd sort of thinking, what's on? David Byrne, Talking Heads, is coming to stay at our house. And there's David Byrne in the kitchen eating Cocoa Pops. It was so wonderful. What he did in my puppet show. But I think life was quite fast, and I needed to...
Kid left.
There because there's, you know, obviously you have the kind of dynamics of being in a high profile relationship, pressure from tabloid scrutiny, general parent stuff, and also a kind of social life that was pretty hedonistic.
It was all too much. All sorts of things happened. I tried to step out of the marriage for a while, and drugs, all sort of craziness with me.
And it was really hard living your life through a lens at that point.
Kid left.
It was quite hard to escape.
What was the turning point?
It's kind of a strange thing when you sort of face things in your life, you know, like addictions, that often you find that you deal with it a little bit, but then you'll sort of slip back into old ways. And I sort of dealt with one thing, and then another thing would sort of affect me. And it took me a couple of attempts to sort that out.
What helped you get that understanding?
And you're meeting other people who had addictions as well. Also, the other thing is that although I would always at school be doing performances and stuff like that, underneath, I'm quite shy. It's weird because you do this job and you're talking, you're gregarious and all these things, but I am actually quite shy, and I think that was a little thing that you could walk into the room if you had a drink. You could be in a room full of musicians, or you could be in a room full of people who were, you know, to you, your heroes, and you could sort of feel that you could hold your own if you had some sort of prop or something that just made you feel a bit more at ease. And I think that is something that happens with a lot of performers and musicians and a lot of people, you know, through your life, that you just start leaning on those things a little bit too much, and you lose sight of who you are and who you are without those things as well. Let's have some more music. What's next? So I've chosen Do I Love You by Fabulous, and I wanted to play something from Billy. Billy was my partner. We've been friends for a few years, and we got together. He had a bit of depression for a huge chunk of his life, and it's so hard to sit and watch Keep Right and care for school with mental health. Losing him was the hardest thing I've ever had to deal with in my life. I think something that's really important to share, I've spoken now to lots of people who work within mental health support network. Make a difference is that there is hope. There is help available. There are ways. We're still learning. For some people, the drugs work. For some people, that isn't the case. But I think it's so isolating to be trapped in your mind like that, where you doubt yourself, you doubt everything you've ever known, you doubt your family love you, you doubt that your friends care for you. I think something else that happens when you lose someone in a situation like this is that I don't want people to remember him for how he died. I want people to remember Billy for how he lived his life. He was so full of love. He would help anyone in need. He was always there for all his friends. He brought so much into my life. He brought so much into his family and into his friends' life. And for me to play a piece of music for him that reflected who he was as a human, he loved to dance. Keep right. And this track will always remind me of him. And it's Do I Love You? And it's by Frank Wilson. I'm not going to be able to do that.
Billy Yates, who tragically took his own life in 2017. Billy was also the inspiration for a challenge that you took on the following year. I'm sure listeners will remember your heroic efforts when you cycled 350 miles from Blackpool, where you were born, to Brighton, where you live, to raise money for Sport Relief and to raise awareness of mental health. What possessed you to say yes to that, bearing in mind that you weren't actually a cyclist?
Well, I think at that point it was I wanted to do something, and the next thing you know, you're off. Towards the end of the bike ride, I had a moment, a real moment, where I think the grief came. It was pretty brutal towards the end.
Well, this is the thing, because watching it back, and perhaps the difference with some of the challenges that we've seen before, is that you have this kind of emotional pain alongside the physical pain, and they're kind of connected, which is strangely appropriate to the story, I think. Was it cathartic? I mean, watching you kind of going through that and keep going in the pouring rain, and you've sort of fallen off the bike and you're on the side of the road there.
In a way, the grief had to come. You're grieving such a process anyway, and in a way that the fact that it came the last day, and it really came so powerfully, and grief does that to you. You don't know when it's going to come at you, but and when it comes, it can take you to your knees, and you have to lay it out. And the production team were talking, saying, "We're going to take her over the top." And I was like, no, you can't, I can't, I won't make it. I know that hill, I can't do it. And Professor Greg was like, you can do this. And we were going up the hill, I was swearing, I was cursing. I think at one point I talked about how it was like giving birth to a sheep. I lost my mind, and the tears were coming. But then suddenly, we were at the top of the hill, and you could see, well, you couldn't see Brighton because the weather was so bad, but I knew where Brighton Pier was. It wasn't that far away. And we sobbed and sobbed, and we made it down. And the donations people were so generous.
What have you learned about mental health and mental well-being that you wish you'd known earlier?
One is to listen sometimes. I think we all want to fix, and we run around trying to fix someone. But actually, sometimes to sit down and just listen. To listen to what they're going through. I think also when you know people who are living with these struggles, you've got to check in. They don't always want to talk. They want to be isolated. They won't want to be a burden. And sometimes you've really got to go one step beyond, and hopefully someone's story will have a more positive.
Prepare to turn left in half an hour.
So we've got... I've chosen Truth by Kamasi Washington, and someone I love dearly sent me this piece of music, and it moved me to tears. But something else I've learned through grieving is how music can play such a role in that. And I'll take some photographs, or I'll take pieces of music, and I can listen to that, and I can help that little process. And sometimes you can make those tears come, and you can think about somebody, and you can...
In 100 feet, turn left.
And then you come out the other side of that, and you feel a little bit stronger again.
Take next left. Over the speed limit. In 100 feet, turn right. In 150 feet, turn right. Washington and Truth. Sir Zoe Ball, as well as your work on radio, you present Strictly Sister Show. In 100 feet. She left the main show in 2005 and finished third. You were over the speed limit.
I think that was certainly my problem. I'm not massively competitive. I say this, my three brothers, right?
In 300 feet. She left.
Lovely, would say. Also, Strictly, people's opinion of me changed. You go from this sort of ladder, this sort of boozy person who's always in trouble. I went on to Strictly, and people did a double take. They're like, hang on a minute, she's in a dress, she's dancing a waltz, she's a lady. And I'll always be grateful to that show. But my nan got to come and watch it. My nan is no longer with us. She came and saw me dance with Ian Waite, and she met Bruce Forsyth, and she absolutely loved it. But the show gifted me so much work and so much fun.
You're obviously still keen to take on competition because the breakfast show slot is, of course, the most competitive of all radio shows, and you present the biggest. Is that a pressure when it comes to the listening figures?
You can pretend it's not, but the listening figures come in and your face is on your team. So yeah, I do take it completely to heart.
And you were over the speed limit.
Yeah, their shows were huge. So we've been there a year and we're still learning. I'm loving it. Hopefully the things will go up with time. I think it takes a little bit of a while to bed in, but I have to say I've had so much support from the listeners. They're so much fun. Also my colleagues, you know, Steve Wright has been brilliant. Ken Bruce, you know, and they're all like, look, so we go up and down.
Which is what Mackenzie, yes.
Steve is just a jar. And these guys are my heroes. And they're like, look, the figures go up and down. It's going to happen. Try not to take it too personally and just keep doing what you're doing. And don't forget the time checks. And you've got to remember it's
in 900 feet. Right.
Need to do this job, and it's fun. Well, one more track to hear before we send you there. What's it going to be? I'll go for the Rolling Stones. You can't always get what you want. This is quite a song that makes you look at life and sort of be quite reflective. Celebrate Glastonbury is my favourite weekend of the year.
Next Ride
on stage was such a moment. It's also taken from a great scene in The Big Chill, which is one of my favourite films, all about marriages and relationships.
Arrive to destination in 300 feet.
You know, you can't always get what you want.
Arrive to destination
at what you need.